Industrial heat, often operating behind the scenes of our modern society, plays a pivotal role in our everyday life. From the food we eat to the buildings we live in, things would look very different without it. But with this utility comes a sizeable emissions footprint. In this video, we'll uncover the hidden world of industrial heat, from the intense furnaces forging the steel in our skyscrapers to the more gentle heat pasteurizing our food. We'll explore the diverse spectrum of industrial heat and the industries that rely on it the most, and how this crucial utility, traditionally reliant on fossil fuels, is now at the forefront of a significant transformation. We're going to look at all of the established and emerging technologies that can tackle even the hottest and heaviest industrial processes. I'm Rosie Barnes. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Industrial heat refers to the energy used in production processes like melting metals or producing steam for factories, and it makes up about 29% of global energy consumption. Now, if we factor in non-process heat, that's the energy used for things like space heating in factories or warming water in commercial laundries, this number jumps to 35%. Combined, they account for about 15 to 20% of global greenhouse gas emissions. To give you some perspective, that's on par with the emissions churned out by the entire transportation sector. Breaking down the contributors, the iron and steel industry is the largest emitter, followed by the chemicals and plastics industry, and then cement. Many industries need heat for thermal manufacturing processes. These include sectors like iron, steel, cement, chemicals, food, beverages, paper, to name just a few. The type of heat these industries require can be broken down into three primary classifications: low, medium, and high temperature. At the coolest end of the scale, low temperature heat is everything up to around 150 degrees Celsius. These kinds of temperatures are needed by the processes primarily within the chemical, food and beverage and paper industries, for processes like drying, evaporation, pasteurization, baking and sterilization. A notch higher, the medium temperature range of 150 to 400 degrees Celsius is vital to other chemical processes, such as more advanced separations and reactions. This range is also used by many refining processes, like in biofuel production, where distillation is used to separate impurities. And in the textile sector, heat treatments for dyeing and finishing, as well as in specific drying processes, often fall within this range. Above 400 degrees Celsius is where things intensify. When we venture into the realm of high temperature heat, we're looking at the backbone of heavy industries like iron, steel, aluminium, and cement production. Also to turn hydrocarbons into plastics and other petrochemicals and high temperature hydrogen electrolysis. For instance, in the steel industry, blast furnaces, which convert iron ore into molten iron, operate at temperatures reaching upward of 650 degrees Celsius. Similarly, the cement industry requires extreme temperatures for the process that converts limestone and other materials into clinker, a primary component of cement. These processes aren't just about reaching the right temperature, they demand intense, sustained heat to drive chemical reactions and transformations. If you want to dive deeper into the production of those two materials and all their emission sources besides just heat, then you can check out this video on cement and any or all of these on iron and steel. If you divide up all of the heat used in industry based on temperature range, the energy demand is almost evenly split between low plus medium heat on one hand and high temperature on the other. So, how is this heat produced? The answer currently is over 90% from fossil fuels. The largest fuel source for industrial heat as of 2018 was coal, supplying 41%. This is followed by gas at 23% and oil at 11%. Renewables, despite their growing prominence in other sectors, only contributed 9% of the industrial heat source in 2018, with a majority of that coming from bioenergy sources like biomass and waste. The current state of industrial heat is fossil fueled, but it doesn't have to be that way. Next, let's explore potential solutions to this energy and emissions challenge. There are a range of zero emissions technologies available for heating, and their difficulty and cost varies roughly in line with the temperature needed. I guess the simplest source of heat is not to create it at all, rather just pull it straight out of the ground. Where the geology suits, direct use of geothermal resources can be used, usually for low temperature processes like fish drying, fish farming, and heating greenhouses. Heat pumps are known for their ability to heat homes to a comfortable temperature, but you may not be aware that the technology has advanced a lot in recent years and they are now supplying a lot of industrial heat. The highest temperature that heat pumps can produce currently is around 130 degrees Celsius, but the upper limit is improving all the time, and the latest record I heard was a prototype system that reached 180 degrees. The technology is a little more advanced than the heat pump you're probably familiar with in your home, but the principle is the same. It's based on refrigeration. It exploits the phase changes of a refrigerant, compressing it to release heat at one end in the condenser and expanding it to absorb heat at the other in the evaporator. The house I live in has both gas heating and an air conditioner. We use the air conditioner as a heater in winter because it's cheaper than turning on the ducted gas heating, not to mention the lower greenhouse gas emissions. And just like me, many industries are finding there are cost and emission savings to be made by moving from fossil fuel heat to heat pumps. Many industries need hot water at temperatures that can easily be provided by heat pumps. Food and beverage companies are using heat pumps to heat water for food processing, such as canning and cooking. Hot water from heat pumps is also being used in the textile industry for dyeing and finishing. These are just a couple of examples of the many industries that are moving from fossil fuel heat to heat pumps, and in every case, it's because there's money to be saved. As the technology continues to improve and costs continue to fall, we can expect to see even more industries making this switch in the future. But heat pumps can only supply low temperature heat currently, and even though they're improving all the time and starting to nudge the lower end of medium temperature heat, it's not going to reach beyond that anytime soon. Furthermore, the main advantage of heat pumps is their incredible effectiveness. The heat pump heating in your home probably has a coefficient of performance, COP, of about 4. That means you put in 1 kilowatt hour of electricity and you get 4 kilowatt hours of heat in your home. But the COPs tend to get lower as temperature increases. At really high temperature, the COP gets closer to 1. So you'd put in a kilowatt hour of electricity and get not that much more than a kilowatt hour of heat out. At that point, there are other simpler and cheaper ways to get the higher temperatures. For example, biomass. There are numerous examples of industry using biomass for heat, especially in paper processing or other industries that generate a lot of waste biomass, and that needs to be got rid of somehow. They might as well use it for their energy needs. Moving up in temperature again, we've reached the high temperature range, which makes up nearly half of total thermal energy demand, remember? Solar thermal is one option for high temperature heat. In the recent video I did on cement, I mentioned a couple of concentrating solar thermal companies, Heliogen in the US and Solpar in France, who are attempting to get the energy for kilns directly from concentrated sunlight. Both have reported achieving temperatures exceeding 1000 degrees Celsius so far. Perhaps the simplest heating method of all is also one of the most versatile. Electric resistance heating is probably one you have in your home in the form of an electric kettle or hot water system, where an element is inserted directly into water and heats up when a current is applied to it. It can be used to heat other materials too. Electric resistance heating can easily reach temperatures of around 800 degrees Celsius. Above that is a little trickier, simply because there aren't many materials that don't melt in that kind of heat. So you need specialist materials and heating elements made of materials like iron, chromium, aluminium alloy, molybdenum, carbon, silicon carbide, or others. For higher temperatures, technologies include electric arc furnaces, which are commonly used in the steelmaking industry for recycling purposes. They work by channeling electric energy directly into heat through an electric arc. This high-intensity heat can then be used to melt scrap steel, converting it into high-quality steel. You might be familiar with induction, perhaps even having it in your kitchen, but its application goes beyond just cooking. In industry, induction can be harnessed to heat and melt metals. This can be either for direct metal processing or to use molten metals as a reagent, catalyst, or even as a heat transfer medium. Microwaves, while a common household item, have some high temperature industrial applications too, and one possibility currently being explored is to provide heat needed in mineral processing. Lastly, there's plasma, an incredibly versatile high-temperature technology. Beyond its prevalent use in high-tech applications like coatings, plasma finds its place in converting municipal solid waste into syngas, albeit with some reservations due to the presence of fossil and chlorinated compounds. So those are a bunch of mature technologies capable of providing even the highest temperatures needed in industry. But in a few challenging applications, the temperature alone isn't all that matters, it is also the quality of heat. To explain why, I need to get a little bit into the science of heat transfer. There are three ways that heat moves around. First, conduction. This is when heat travels through a solid material. Imagine a metal spoon in a hot pot of soup. The handle gets hot even though it's not in the soup. That's conduction, heat moving through the spoon from the hot end to the cooler handle. Next is convection. This involves heat moving through fluids, which includes liquid and gases. A good example is boiling water. The water at the bottom heats up, becomes lighter, rises to the top, while the cooler water sinks down to replace it, creating a circular motion. This movement helps to distribute the heat. Finally, there's radiation. Different from the first two, radiation doesn't need a medium like solids or fluids to transfer heat. It works through electromagnetic waves, and it's the same way that sunlight heats the earth. Even in space, where there is no air, the sun's heat reaches us through radiation. In industrial processes, the effectiveness of these heat transfer modes varies. Radiation is the most effective, followed by convection, and then conduction is the least. Each mode has its unique role depending on the process and the desired outcome. Let's go back to the example of cement again. One of the most critical steps is clinkering. Here, calcium oxide mixes with materials like silica, aluminium, and iron to form what is known as clinker materials, the key ingredient that holds cement together. This reaction needs a very high temperature of around 1450 degrees Celsius. In traditional cement kilns, this heat is provided by a flame that produces intense visible and infrared light. The kiln is a large rotating tube lined with heat-resistant materials. It's so important to use energy efficiently here, ensuring as much heat as possible goes into making the clinker and as little as possible is lost. The flame's position near the materials means it uses all three heat transfer modes: radiation, conduction, and convection. In a traditional kiln, the vast majority of the heat transfer is through radiation, which is the most effective method. Now think, if we wanted to avoid using a flame and instead use electric resistance for heating with a heat source outside the kiln, then we would lose the benefit of radiative heating. The heat would have to travel through the kiln's layers to reach the materials, which would happen by conduction, the least efficient mode of heat transfer. This method would require the heating elements reach even higher temperatures than the process itself needs, leading to increased energy use and the challenge of finding materials that can withstand these extreme temperatures. These challenges are why, even though electric resistant elements can reach the temperatures needed in clinkering, so far electric cement kilns remain in the prototype and pilot stage. For very demanding heating processes that really just want a flame, biomass, biogas, e-fuels are low emissions options for something that we can burn for varying amounts of extra cost. Now let's talk about hydrogen, a topic which has been conspicuous by its absence in this video so far. It's probably the number one mentioned technology when decarbonizing heat is discussed in the media. Hydrogen is indeed another option for any temperature of heat, from home heating to these challenging processes that we've just been discussing. But there's a reason why I didn't mention it until now, because, well, yes, you can replace methane with hydrogen if you really want to. You probably can't afford to. Now, I don't want to get hijacked and have this turn into a video about hydrogen, so let's just really briefly talk about why. First, its efficiency is only around 50% when converting electricity to hydrogen and then to heat. So you need twice as much energy compared to electric resistance heating, and the comparison to heat pumps is even worse. Additionally, switching from methane to hydrogen isn't totally straightforward. Hydrogen can cause materials to become brittle, and its combustion characteristics are also different, so it needs specific engineering adjustments and careful handling. It isn't a matter of simply substituting hydrogen for gas in existing equipment. So, well, yeah, hydrogen has the technical potential to be used for industrial heat. It's not one that's likely to be chosen often, as other technologies offer more practical and efficient alternatives for different industrial processes. So despite this very wide range of zero emission options for industrial heat that we've just gone through, over 90% still comes from fossil fuels. Why? Two main reasons: cost and availability. Historically, heating with fossil fuels has been cheaper than using renewable energy. However, this is starting to change. Renewable energy costs are dropping, and with recent spikes in gas prices, renewable options like heat pumps are becoming more economically attractive for companies. But it's not just about cost. Industrial operations need reliable heat delivered precisely where and when it's needed. Let's tackle the where part first. Unlike natural gas, which is easily transported through pipelines, renewable heat isn't as straightforward to move. District heating is one way to do that, and it's popular in Nordic countries. In fact, that's how my apartment was heated when I lived in Denmark, and it was cozy and cheap and awesome. In Denmark, it's a key part of the energy system, also supporting industrial needs like in breweries. And in Iceland, geothermal district heating supports various industries also, from fish drying to pharmaceuticals. However, district heating usually operates at temperatures around 100 degrees Celsius, which is lower than most industrial processes require. District heating networks want to keep temperatures low to minimize losses, so it doesn't really work that well to supply district heating hot enough for your hottest industrial need on the same network as building heating. Concentrated solar thermal is another renewable heat technology that suffers on the where part. CSP can't go just anywhere to the extent that solar PV can. As I mentioned in my video on that topic, it needs consistent and really strong sunlight to work. That limits where it can go, and while some processing facilities will be happy to locate where heat is abundant if it's cheap enough, most probably don't want to relocate away from population centres. While the where of renewable heating is about geographic feasibility, the when is equally crucial, especially as we rely more on wind and solar power. These sources are becoming some of the cheapest available, but their variability presents challenges. Industrial processes often require constant, uninterrupted operation, and aligning this with the intermittent intermittent nature of wind and solar isn't always possible. In some areas, hydro or geothermal can provide this consistent power. Elsewhere, nuclear energy might be a more cost-effective option. However, combining wind and solar with storage solutions is emerging as what is usually the cheapest approach. I've talked a lot about electricity storage on this channel, including some thermal storage methods that involve converting electricity into heat and then back into electricity. The challenge of electricity storage is far more complex than heat storage, and you pay for that complexity either with money in the case of expensive technologies like lithium-ion batteries, or with efficiency such as in any of the cheaper thermal energy storage systems that I've covered on this channel. They typically operate at around 40% efficiency. If your application is industrial heat, however, you don't need to convert back to electricity. You can store the heat as heat without any need to turn heat into electricity. This approach is much more efficient because converting electricity back and forth inevitably leads to energy loss. Storing heat as heat aligns with the principles of thermodynamics, minimizing these losses. This has big implications. Electricity storage is a challenging and expensive part of decarbonizing our electricity grids. And the electricity grid is set to become much larger over the next couple of decades as transport, buildings, and industry electrify. On the face of it, that sounds like an extra challenge for a future grid sourced largely from variable renewables. But electrifying industrial heat, if it's combined with thermal energy storage, could actually complement wind and solar power in the electricity grid very well. With thermal storage, industrial heat users will have a buffer available and will be able to purchase electricity mostly when there's a surplus of solar and wind when it's cheap, and draw from that stored heat instead of the grid when prices are higher. That will help to lower the peaks and raise the troughs of the variable electricity supply, and it will be much cheaper than electricity storage technologies like lithium-ion batteries. There are a range of thermal energy storage technologies being developed now, including the sponsor of today's video, Rondo Energy. Their heat battery is an example of an electric thermal energy storage system built for heavy industry. To learn more, you can check out rondo.com. And Rondo have invited me to tour their production facility, so stay tuned for a future video on that next year. If you're worried about the impartiality of this video, given that it is a topic related to its sponsor, I invite you to check out my sponsorship policy and the steps that I take to avoid bias. I will be making more sponsored content in the future. The channel simply needs that money to survive, but not at the expense of independence. I've put a link to my policy in the description if you want to read it in full, but the main point is that I don't allow sponsors to dictate talking points, and they don't have the right to veto anything that I say on any video that I publish. Thanks for watching, and if you'd like to join the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team, you can do so at this link. I'll see you in the next video.